So tonight we're going to move forward. We have a special treat tonight because we've been talking about what does it mean to be a Christian and an American. And one of the things we have to look at tonight is this idea of America as a superpower in the world. Of course, America wasn't always a superpower, but for the better part of pretty much everybody's lifetime here, America has been a superpower. So we have a great treat. I'd like to welcome forward one of our finest men in the military, Jason McEvers. Let's give him a big hand.
Thanks for having me. Yeah.
So I want to thank you thank you for your service. And do we have any other military people serving right now that are in the audience? Can you please stand if you're here?
John
is here. Anybody else?
I see some kids of military families here.
Okay.
Awesome.
John, thank you. So let's talk a little bit. What was it that motivated you, Jason, to join up in the, you're in the Army National Guard, correct?
I am. 23 years now. I know I look way older.
Wow.
I enjoy it. My kids, this is all they've known. I go to work like this every day.
Oh my gosh, it's a fight! Fight! Fight!
Hey,
it's
hey,
a fight!
Hey.
Fight!
Easy. What is going on?
I surrender.
Okay.
What do you want? Who are you?
You took my parking spot.
Your parking spot?
Yeah.
You want my parking spot?
Yeah.
And so that means that you can jump on me?
Yeah.
And think that by being some kind of a crazy bully, and being intimidating, trying to be intimidating, you can take my parking spot?
Yeah.
That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
I know.
What is going on with you? What's your name?
Mateo.
Okay. I'm going to talk to you after I'm done with Randy, okay?
Okay.
I don't want to see you back on this stage tonight.
Okay.
I'd like to see you in the crowd on Sunday, not tonight. Okay.
Bye.
I'll talk to you in
a
little bit.
Yeah, go find your own parking spot.
Okay.
Parking spot?
God.
Really, Randy?
That's crazy. I got to say, I actually think you were pretty merciful to him because, I mean, you're way bigger and stronger. You could have, like, crushed him like a grape.
Could have.
Yeah.
He didn't deserve it. I didn't feel that threatened, but I can't believe that he would do that to me, but I understand there's something going on in his life that he needs to work out.
I see.
So,
yeah.
I have
a mugging! A mugging! He's mugging him!
What are you doing?
I swear.
Now what do you want?
Oh.
I'm hungry.
Hey. You're hungry?
Yeah.
Okay. So if you're hungry, you're going to come to me and jump on me?
Yeah.
And what are you going to get out of that?
Food.
Food, huh? Okay.
You know, he doesn't walk around with Chick McNuggets or anything, you know.
Looks like it.
You know what? I appreciate what you want. When's the last time you ate?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
Oh, my goodness. I feel sorry for you. You know what? That's all I've got. I've got $5 here.
Thank you.
There's down the hill, there's a gas station. It's a little, like, mini-mart. Buy what you need, and that'll get you through tonight and probably tomorrow morning. And do you understand what a job is? Like, to
what's,
work?
What's that?
A job is where you have a talent or a skill or just, you know, want to work for somebody to do a job. Yeah, put it away. And they pay you to do that. And then you learn a skill and get better and better and better and get money to buy things and especially food.
Okay.
We'll talk later, okay? I'm trying to do something with Randy.
Okay, bye.
Mateo, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, go get a corn dog or something, huh?
Man,
I'm telling you, you are way more nice than me, because I would have, like, put him in a sleeper hole or something like that, you know? I mean,
he seems like a nice person in some
ways.
He attacked you, and you gave
him money.
I know. I can see the aggression in him, though, and I just...
Freeze! Oh, it's a Nerf gun! He's got a Nerf gun!
What are you doing? Look out there. Look at all those people.
What are you doing?
I don't know.
What? Do you have any idea what this is? This isn't even a real gun. It's no bullets in it.
Are you scared of something? Like, is something really scaring you? Are you trying to be a bully because somebody is bullying you?
Yeah.
Bullying has never, ever, ever worked.
Do you have a brain under that hat?
Not really.
You are not going to be able to protect yourself with this.
Okay.
I like it. It's fun. My kids have them. This is not something that you're going to protect yourself.
Okay.
Okay?
Let me teach you some ways to protect yourself, okay?
Okay.
I have had a lot of experience, and we will definitely teach you a way, many ways to protect yourself. I like you. I can mold you, and you can be a better person.
Okay.
Let's go. Why don't you go,
Randy,
because, you know.
I appreciate it, but I'm going to take this guy.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Let's give him a hand. Yeah. You were really scared, weren't you? I could tell you were scared. Yeah. Let's pray. Gracious Father, you give us commands. And sometimes those commands are easy to obey, and sometimes they're hard. You tell us to not kill. You tell us to love our neighbor as ourselves. You tell us to even love our enemies. We all probably admit, Lord, that that last one especially is hard. And then sometimes in life, Lord, it's hard because on the one hand, you've told us not to kill, but on the other hand, somebody's trying to kill our neighbor. How do we love our neighbor in that situation? Do we just watch? We ask the guidance of your Spirit. Give us your insight, Holy Spirit. Come be our teacher and remind us once again that as imperfect as this nation is, that in the journey, in the history of this country, it has been still again absolutely and utterly unique in how it has conducted itself. We pray this and we pray for our nation. In your name, amen. How are you guys doing tonight? Good. Excellent. So, along comes Mateo, and he is attacking Jason, this American soldier. And, of course, Jason was very merciful. I mean, I actually suggested to Rob, we should put, like, a wrestling mat down, and, like, Jason should, like, body slam him and stuff. But then we didn't want to get in trouble, so... But, I mean, the truth is that Jason could have just totally crushed that kid. And many times in the history of our nation, we have found ourselves in wars where we really were in a position to not just conquer our enemies, but to crush our enemies. And to crush them in ways that actually, historically, would have been consistent with the way that war has been conducted for eons, for millennia. For example, the practice of war has, war is always ugly. War is always, it's never preferable. You're always looking for a better way, a diplomatic solution. You're always looking to negotiate, for sure. But war in the early times was far worse in many ways than it is today. Now, we have weapons today that are clearly more destructive. An F-16 is more destructive than a bow and arrow. An atomic bomb is terrifyingly destructive. And yet, in many ways, war was more brutal earlier in history. For example, what countries would do is they would practice something called the conquest ethic. Young lady, can I have your attention now? Okay, thank you. I might have to practice the conquest ethic on you if you don't pay attention. So, the conquest ethic was the idea that if I want something, then I'll just take it from you. And if I'm stronger than you, you can't do anything about it. Oh, that's attached. Holy moly. That could have been ugly. I didn't want to take your head with it, so I guess so. Well, you were the smarter one, that's for sure. So they just took it. And in the process of doing that, when nations would war against each other, they would just take stuff. And they didn't care what the collateral damage was. They didn't care who got hurt. In fact, a lot of times in the past, who got hurt was exactly the point. Today, when there are wars, We actually have rules of war. We have things like the Geneva Convention with rules of war. When we attack somebody as the United States, one of the things that we take very great pains to be careful about is trying to make sure that civilians, non-military people, are not hurt. Well, back in the day, killing civilians was the point. For example, in this ugly history of the conquest ethic, in Syria, they were known for absolutely torturing and brutalizing the people that they conquered. This is a relief of Assyrians flaying their prisoners alive. That means they skinned them alive. This was common. The Assyrians are the people that Jonah was called to go preach to. There's a reason Jonah ran away. He knew how bad they were. VeggieTales takes the story and they say they were bad because they would hit each other with fish. Oh my goodness, are you kidding me? The Ninevites routinely brutalized their enemies, brutalized each other. Flaying, torture, beheading, child sacrifice. It was not uncommon at all. If you were at war with the Assyrians, you better win, because if you don't win, it's not going to be pretty. Not at all. So that was one part of the conquest ethic. Absolutely and utterly kill your enemies. Another practice that the Assyrians did, and many others too, was they practiced the idea of killing all the males in a population that they conquered. If you were a male, you were dead, because they wanted to neutralize any ability for that population to have a civil revolt. Another one. Here's a relief. This is the diaspora of Israel. Now, diaspora is just a big word, and what it means is that somewhere around the 400s BC, because Israel was no longer in obedience to God, in covenant with God, God said, listen, you better change or else I'm going to lift my hand of protection from you. The Lord was protecting them from her enemies. Israel didn't want to listen, wouldn't listen. Decades went by, centuries went by. Finally, the Lord said, I gotta lift my hand. And he allowed the Babylonians to come in and conquer Israel. Temple destroyed. All the people of Israel, most of them at least, pulled out of Israel and taken and spread all across the empire of Babylonia. This is why when we read about Esther or Daniel or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're not in Israel. They're in other parts of the Babylonian empire. They were part of the diaspora. And by the way, probably at least 50% of the people that were taken, this wasn't a pleasant walk. Half the people didn't live through it. They didn't live through the journey. The Psalms have some absolutely crushing verses about how they would take babies and smash them against the cliffs. The conquest ethic. How about the Romans? Probably no empire in history ever exercised the biggest land grab than the Roman Empire. That is a lot of land. That's the better part, pretty much all of Europe, pretty much all of Asia Minor, and the entire northern coast of Africa. The whole point of the Roman Empire? More. Get more. More land. More slaves. They conquered, they enslaved. More, more, more. So, conquest ethic. Brutalize your enemies. Kill all the men. Spread people all throughout your empire to neutralize them. Grab as much land as you can. That was the conquest ethic. The Vikings. Who here is Scandinavian? We have a few Vikings here. Well, at least genetically. Hopefully not in practice, right? The Vikings may have been the most brutal people group in history. The things that they did, not only to their enemies, but often to each other, I can't even tell you. I can't even explain it. Enslavement was common. Again, all the things I talked about, the Vikings did. Total destruction. Burning, pillaging. We want it, we take it. If you can't stop me, I don't care. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a Lutheran pastor. In 1939, I believe, he was living on the east coast of the United States. He was teaching at a seminary. A seminary is a college for pastors. He was teaching at a seminary called Union, just about the time Adolf Hitler was consolidating his power in Nazi Germany, just about the time that he was beginning the process of creating his concentration camps, just about the time when they were just starting to raid the Warsaw ghettos of the Jews and get them. Bonhoeffer, a German, could have stayed in the United States and stayed safe. But he saw something that he couldn't deny. He saw the evil that was growing, and he saw that the church in Germany compromised with Hitler. Go on Google tonight and look up church and Nazi Germany and look up images, and I promise you, you will find pictures of pastors paying homage to Hitler. Bonhoeffer couldn't live with it. Knowing the danger, got on a boat, went back to Nazi Germany, and started an underground church movement called the Confessing Church. Bonhoeffer was a pacifist. Do you understand what a pacifist is? A pacifist is somebody who believes in peace at all costs, no violence, nonviolence. He was a pacifist, and he sought to work against the Nazi regime as much as possible, nonviolently. Until one of his relatives, who was part of the resistance movement, showed him evidence and pictures of what was going on in the concentration camps. Bonhoeffer eventually would take part in one of the assassination attempts on Hitler, even though he was a pacifist, because he realized something. Sometimes doing nothing is worse than doing something. This was the attempt popularized in the movie Valkyrie. It failed. Bonhoeffer was put into Dachau, eventually into Dachau concentration camp, and he was hung 2 days before the camp was liberated by Allied forces. Unbelievable loss. But this is what he said. Read it with me. We are not to simply bandage the wounds of victims beneath the wheels of injustice. We are to drive a spoke into the wheel itself. And this is the hard part, isn't it? Because we are supposed to be nonviolent. We are supposed to be peace-loving. We are supposed to be... What did Jesus say? Blessed are the peacemakers, right? We are. We are. And yet, how do we do that? How do we love our neighbor if our neighbor is being brutally attacked and we do nothing? These are actually difficult decisions, aren't they? This is why we need to pray for our leaders, because these are not easy decisions. And I would always encourage all of us, to always be really careful about just quickly second-guessing our leaders, because oftentimes we don't know all the information. These are hard decisions. These are really hard decisions. So in the history of the conquest ethic, what about America? What makes America different? What makes America special? To be consistent with our theme, we're going to actually hear now for the next 4 minutes from somebody who's not an American, who's going to tell us and remind us why America is special. Pay special attention to what he says about how we've handled ourselves in war. Let's watch.
G'day there. As an outsider, I have a unique perspective from which to view America. As an American friend said to me, sometimes it takes someone on the outside to remind us what we're like on the inside. I'm an Australian, you might have already guessed that, and I love my home country, and I am proud that my nation has long been a reliable American ally. But I know that Australia is not America, and that my country has not achieved what America has achieved. No country in human history has. What makes America different? There are many answers, but start with one you might not have thought of. Most people think America is all about success. I see it a little differently. I think America is all about failing. Most people in the world don't get the chance to fail, but Americans take it for granted. Only Americans say, if at first you don't succeed, try, try again. There's even an academic study to prove this. According to a study by Harvard Business School professor Stephen Rogers, most entrepreneurs fail four times before they succeed. Success takes timing and hard work, some good luck, many other factors. But to succeed, you must be given the chance to fail, and you must accept responsibility if you do. I love that about Americans. At their best, they don't blame others. They learn from their mistakes and do better the next time. And in America, there's almost always a next time. Nowhere else are you as free to take entrepreneurial risks. Talk to someone who has tried to start a small business in Germany or Brazil, and you'll see what I mean. From the outside looking in, I can only admire this. And I'm not the only one. Just take a look at the CEOs of major Silicon Valley companies. You will see the names of entrepreneurs from all over the world: India, Pakistan, Russia, Israel, you name the country. Why did they come to America to innovate? Because there's a lot of money here? Yes, of course, that's part of it. But there's a lot of money in London and Berlin and Tokyo as well. They came to America because America gave them the chance to fail, and therefore the best chance in the world to succeed. And the rest of the world can thank their lucky stars for America's economic success. Not only is America by far the world's largest economy, it is also the world's largest consumer. And the world's economy depends on being able to sell to America. It would also be perfectly natural for Americans to want to keep all this wealth to themselves, but they don't. Just the opposite, in fact. America has been the most selfless nation in the history of the world. Yet another way in which America is different. What other nation fights for the freedom of others? In Europe, in two world wars, in Korea, in Vietnam, and yes, in Iraq. In all those wars, America had very little or nothing to gain economically. Whenever there is a humanitarian crisis anywhere in the world, Haiti after a hurricane, Indonesia after a tsunami, who is the first to rush aid to these places? No matter where the calamity is, at home or abroad, Americans invariably raise millions of dollars almost instantly to send food and clothing and supplies to people in distress they don't know and will never meet. Who else does that? I love that America is different. What worries me about America is that...
That's enough. So, in the history of the world, where the conquest ethic was the way that everybody did stuff, America was really the first nation on a large scale to say, we're going to do it differently. Instead of a conquest ethic, America has a different kind of ethic, and it shows itself in different ways. For example, militarily. It is not our intention militarily to grab land, to crush our enemies, to take their resources. That's not what we've done. Instead, our ethic is different. It's actually reconstruction. For example, the Iraq War, 8,000 Americans dead, cost our nation, at least up to this point, $4.79 trillion. And I remember when we entered that war, I remember a lot of people said, well, America's just doing that because they want the oil. They want the oil. And yet there we were, after Kuwaitis and the Republican Guard of the Iraqis lit all those wells on fire. Who paid to have those wells stabilized? It was us. Who did it at great danger? It was us. Did we keep the oil? No. That is not the conquest ethic, is it? When we were attacked on 9/11, we tracked down the people who did this. We identified them as a group called Al-Qaeda. They were also connected to another group in Afghanistan called the Taliban. Afghanistan, there was a time when Afghanistan was a wonderful, prosperous country. And if you were a woman then in Afghanistan, you could get an education, you could start a business, you could do all that. But when the Taliban took over, ladies, you had no rights. You had no right to an education. You couldn't even show your face. Beatings of women were common. What did we do? 3,000 American dead as we fought them, even as we were pouring food rations out to the people there. Is that the conquest ethic? No, it isn't. Go back even further. World War II. Massive global war. In Europe, the Pacific, Africa, 405,000 Americans died during World War II. And what did we do after we conquered Germany, after we conquered Japan? Unconditional surrenders. What would another country have done 2,000 years ago? They would have took it all. They'd have took the land. They'd have took everything. What did we do? We spent $14.2 billion helping Germany to rebuild. It was called the Marshall Plan. What else did we do? In Japan, we spent $23.7 billion helping Japan to rebuild. And now, they're some of our strongest allies. They're also among the more healthy countries in this world. If you want to see the difference between a country that is allied with America and understands American values and seeks to be part of America's freedom versus a country that has not, all you got to do is look at the Korean Peninsula. Korea, split into two countries, right? North, South. Right? North Korea. This is what economic prosperity looks like in North Korea. They have a dictator. What's his name, Josh Jordan? Is it Kim Jong-un, right? He's insane. And his family members who were dictators before him were insane too. They claim to be gods. Meanwhile, their people starve to death. How bad is it in North Korea? Substantiated reports now of human cannibalism. That's how bad it is. In contrast, 20 miles difference between North and South Korea. South Korea. Why? Because they let us help them. Because we didn't practice the conquest ethic. We have a history of helping our enemies. That's pretty stark, isn't it? Some of the best people I've known were South Koreans. When I went to a seminary in Fuller Seminary in California, where I went as a white person, I was the minority. The majority of students there were South Koreans. Wonderful, unbelievably hardworking, industrious, respectful, really smart people. I have nothing but admiration for them. Nothing but admiration. So, we militarily have a different kind of ethic. But not only that, we also have a different kind of ethic when it comes to economics, how we do money and business and things. I know that capitalism, it's pretty vogue for people to want to criticize capitalism today. Oh, the evil bankers on Wall Street and all this, you know. And for sure, there are definitely at times abuses of this stuff in our country. Absolutely. And we should always be working against that. But it's insanity, you guys, to throw the system away and adopt something like socialism just because of that. Do you know what socialism is doing in Venezuela right now? People are starving in Venezuela. And this is a country that is absolutely wealthy in oil reserves. Yeah. Economically, we don't take stuff. We create wealth. That's what we do in this country. Okay. Dogwash Bugatti, a professor at Columbia University, indicated this, and he's from India. He said, because of capitalism, over the last 50 years, 200 million people have been lifted out of poverty in India because of the free market that they've adopted. China, 400 to 500 million people have been lifted out of poverty because they have a chance to make something of themselves now. You see a business owner, you thank them because they took the risk to open a business. And we have the ability to do that here, and that's special. Don't you forget it. Is it perfect? No, of course not. People aren't perfect. And then finally, this one, philanthropy. Do you guys know what philanthropy is? Okay, it comes from the Greek word philos, which means love, okay? Anthropos, man, love of man. It's the what we do is philanthropy is usually generally used as a word to talk about how much giving of money do we do? How generous are we as a people? Okay? So I heard somebody once say, America actually is not the most generous country in the world. If you look at what each government gives to social needs across the world, America is not the most generous country. Which, if you only look at government, you might be right about that. But you know what they didn't do? They didn't take into account what the actual people in those countries gave. And guess what? Who are the most generous people in the world? Per capita, we are. And actually, the truth be told, it's not even close. Nick Adams is right. Who's the first on the scene? Think of all the nonprofit entities in this country, the Red Cross, Doctors Without Borders, Salvation Army, all of these things who help worldwide. They happen in America. So I just want to stress to you guys that we're very special here and we are different. Yes, we're not perfect. Absolutely. But please, please, take a moment to thank your lucky stars. The only land, unlike the Roman Empire, that we've ever asked for from our conquered enemies, Colin Powell said this, is land to bury our dead. It's the cemetery in Normandy, where we stormed the beaches of France to liberate Europe from Nazi Germany. Pray with me. Gracious Father, help us to love our neighbor as ourselves. Show us how to love our enemies. And when war is necessary, we ask that you would guide us and help us, as Lincoln said, to see the right as best as we can. But help us to be a force for good, a force for freedom, a force for hope, a force for prosperity in this world. We are grateful that you have shown us the path, and we pray that we would continue to. And help us to be grateful that we live in the United States of America. We ask that you would bless it, and we ask that you would help us to bless you. In your name, all God's people said, amen. Amen.